First of all, a very welcome again, and a particular welcome to Fr Willie McFadden. The Second Vatican Council, one of its really important documents is the Constitution on Divine Revelation. And that's what I think we're going to talk about tonight. Is that a reasonable point? Okay, so thanks very much.
The prayer that
Fr
Willie McFadden is part of what we're doing here is being encouraged to enter into the whole experience of the Second Vatican Council because we're celebrating this year of faith. So we can pray this together. Lord Jesus, you entrusted to your church with the mission to proclaim the good news to all the nations. You sent the Holy Spirit to strengthen those who are in the mission of salvation. And this year, may the same Holy Spirit strengthen our faith and inspire us with the words and deeds that by our efforts, the men and women of our time will hear of you, will believe in you, and will come to the beauty of knowing you. We live and reign with God the Father in unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Dei Verbum as the document which really kind of helped us to understand what divine revelation was all about. Give us the opportunity just to look at that and to enter into the whole experience of what God offers us in this communication. But just to say, this is the kind of plan for this evening. If we get through that, fine. If we don't, then that's okay. We'll just go as far as we have to go. But basically what I'd like to do, in order to understand where Scripture fits into our understanding as a result of the Second Vatican Council and how Scripture is part of that whole concept of God's communication to us, to look at Dei Verbum as the document on Revelation, first of all, the background to this particular document and the genesis of the document itself, the difficulties that were entailed before it actually came to be promulgated, look at what the document says a wee bit, and then to unpack Revelation in order to understand the Scriptures. Revelation as personal, that's a huge change in our understanding of church teaching, that God communicates to us as individual persons and in a personal way. And if we understand Revelation at all, it's got to be filtered through the centrality of Christ. So, Christ is the source of Revelation and is the means of that Revelation. But Dei Verbum, especially, incredibly important and powerful. Initially, the bishops were presented with a draft on what Revelation was all about, what God's communication was for us. And it was presented at the first session of the council in 1962. And where it came from was when John the 23rd organised the council, there were groups of officials in the Vatican and the Curia who were given the task of compiling the schema which would be used and given to the bishops. They thought all they'd have to do is present this and it would be rubber stamped by the bishops, the council would be over and they'd all go back to doing what they'd done before. So, the very conservative Curia put forward a document on Revelation which basically said the same as had been coming from the last 400 years. Council fathers rejected it. At the very beginning, they threw it out and said, that is not what we want to talk about. That is not what the communication of God is about today. Wonderful, decisive moment when the council fathers took control of the council themselves, drafting it away from the curial cardinals and the curial officials who thought they were there to just kind of keep things going as before. The subject matter of what the church had understood then by the term divine revelation was then discussed at further sessions of the council, and the final document wasn't even promulgated until the fourth session. So even though it started in the first one in 1962, it was 1965 before Dei Verbum actually became an official teaching of the church. So it tells us there was a struggle in order to come to understand what revelation is all about. It didn't come into existence very easily. You can imagine when there are so many people with differing views trying to be heard. So, especially over a 4-year cycle, it wasn't always easy. And the end result is a very good document, but it is a compromise document. Like all the documents of the Second Vatican Council, it brings in various things and is a compromise document. So I have to recognise that, because it's bringing together so many strands of theology and teaching and awareness of the church. But saying that, was the background, but greatly influenced by some of the very influential figures at the Second Vatican Council, and it's a wonderful document for us just to kind of unpack a wee bit in order to understand where the scriptures fit in and how God communicates to us. So, as basically background, what about revelation? Because revelation is the whole concept that Dei Verbum is about God communicating to us. And if we don't have that revelation, as Joel was saying, then everything else will just flounder. So, Dei Verbum, it teaches that revelation is a personal communication between God and the human person. Okay, so God communicates to us, not in propositions or anything, but God communicates to the human person in a personal way which shows itself in word and in deed. Okay, so that's the kind of summary of what it's trying to tell us. In other words, what we call the communication of God, revelation of God, is a freely given invitation by God to all human beings to enter into a personal relationship of friendship with Him. That's wonderfully open and welcoming and just encouraging that God is not just a God who's up there and beyond, but God is a God who wishes to be in a personal relationship with every single individual person. And that relationship is a relationship of friendship. Prior to the council, and in that initial draft of the document, revelation was really understood as little more than a collection of distinct truth statements. God has revealed truths to us. There are seven sacraments. Jesus is God. That kind of thing. So as long as we knew what these truths were, then that's what God was revealing to us. So we can have a body of truth, and then we know what God was about, what God was wanting to communicate to us. This was then called a propositional model of revelation. And that was the major understanding of how God communicated with us through propositions and in a propositional sense. But Dei Verbum, as this document, demonstrates an overall shift from a propositional model to a far more personal model of revelation. So if we're thinking, how do we understand God? We've got to go beyond proposition. We've got to go beyond narrow statement. We've got to go to the level of encounter, which becomes a lot more dynamic and a lot more relational. God, therefore, doesn't reveal a collection of information to us. That's not what God's about. God is not up there saying, this is what I want you to know. Rather, God shares God's very self with us. That's what revelation is. God shares God's own self with us. That's the meaning of God's communication. So, with Dei Verbum, you see that whole shift away from proposition and remote truth to encounter and to relationship. And now the church teaches that God doesn't just want us to master a body of information about God, which is a temptation. Rather, God wants us to share that divine life He has. That's what's being communicated. God is communicating His desire. God is communicating His willingness to be in relationship with us. So revelation is God's self-manifestation as a being, as God who is both personal and relational. And so in communication, God is always revealing Himself as this Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit, who by His very nature is self-giving. That's what revelation is about. And anything we do in the church after that has got to have that as its foundation. So sacraments only make sense if the God we encounter in the sacraments is the one who's relational and the one who's giving of His very self to us. And what's also incredibly important, that in order to understand the scriptures and understand the tradition of the church, that revelation, it only takes place for us within this context of human history. It's within the history that God is communicating with us. So God is not out there beyond history. God's communication with us is through that very existence of what He has created. And it's into that history that Christ is born. And so if the centrality of our understanding of God, the supreme communication of God, is God Himself in the person of Jesus Christ, then that happens as a human being within the context of history. Okay, so you can see how the revelation is moving forward. It's giving us a different context, and council fathers had to fight with each other to get that across, but to become far more open and to move away from a kind of closed notion of God and a way in which God is all about truths rather than truth itself. But what it moved us towards was actually, if we want to know God, and God is communicating in any way to us, Christ is the supreme revelation. Now, that doesn't seem anything new to us, but it was new then. It was revolutionary. All revelation is focused there in that person of Jesus Christ, and it's through our understanding of the supreme revelation of Christ that we understand who God is and what God might be at all. So, God's sharing of his own divine self with us is done most fully in the person of Jesus Christ, because Christ is God's supreme revelation. So we want to talk about revelation and communication of God. It's not a body of truths, it's not some message, it's not something which is not understandable. It is the person of Jesus Christ. The person of Christ who comes to communicate God to us. So if we want to know God, we really have got to know Christ, because Christ is that perfection of God's communication to us. Right? So moving deeper and deeper into the communication of God and God's revelation, God's personal communication with us, we have to focus on who Christ is. So for Dei Verbum, revelation has reached its fulfillment. There can be no further, no greater revelation than we have in Christ, because Christ is the fullness of God. So in his life, his death, and his resurrection, we are given the complete communication of God. God in his fullness has revealed himself to us in Christ's life, death, and resurrection. Therefore, nothing can be added to that. And all subsequent revelation of God, all communication of God with us in a personal, intimate, friendly manner, is somehow rooted in the foundation of what God and who God has revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. How has Christ revealed God? In word and in deed. So those two experiences have communicated God to us. So what that means is that there's only one way God communicates to us, and that is that one source of revelation, which is God's ongoing personal communication rooted in the life, death, and resurrection of Christ himself. Previously, there was an idea that how did God communicate with us? Before we could come to this notion of Christ, it was like two things. God communicates with the scriptures, which are the revealed word of God, and the tradition of the church, which are the things which are not within scripture, but are still important that God wants us to know. Two kind of notions, two strands that were taking place. So prior to the document of Dei Verbum, revelation was primarily this kind of sense of deposit of faith. It was a defined set of dogmas. It was a rule. It was a set of doctrines that could clearly be delineated and upheld to say, this is what God wants. Okay? So that communication, that was the propositional notion which was there. But when it had been rejected by the Council Fathers, what they were doing was rejecting the notion of the two-source theory of revelation. Because the final document doesn't go down that line and specifically does not say that God reveals himself in scripture and God reveals himself in tradition of the church. In the truths of scripture, the life, the miracles, etc., and the truths of the church, which are being communicated, seven sacraments, Trinity, all that kind of idea. But rather the document gives this idea that scripture and tradition are united in the one source of revelation. Okay? So there's a unity between the revelation which is God offers us in scripture and the revelation which God offers us through the tradition. And so those two things must come together and can't be understood if they are separated. Because in doing this, uniting scripture and tradition, rejecting the two-source theory, the council avoided the idea that the origins of some doctrines and truths can be traced to scripture and some can be traced to tradition. Right? So that kind of sense that some things are in scripture and we can believe them because they're in scripture. Now, there are some things we believe them even though they're not in scripture because they're part of this tradition. Now, Vatican II did away with that. It brought that all together in the one communication of God, teaching us that scripture and tradition are a single deposit that are the word of God. Okay? So the word of God which has been entrusted to the Church is the Word of God, which is not only the written Word of Scripture, which is not only the communicated Word, the tradition, the lived faith of the Church, which is there, but it's the unity of all that, bringing it all together. So what has been rejected is the tradition, that idea that we in the Church have a tradition which constitutes a comparable authoritative source to divine revelation, basically adding non-scriptural truths to the deposit of faith. And that's still what a lot of people understand by tradition. They think that that's what tradition is. We've got these non-scriptural truths, which are almost the equivalent of the scriptural truths. That's a million miles from what the document is teaching about revelation. It's teaching us of the unity of scripture and tradition. It's teaching us that as a church, this deposit of faith is a lived experience centered in the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, and is one source that we enter into in order to experience the communication of God. So in uniting scripture and uniting tradition, Dei Verbum was incredibly controversial and has advanced us beyond the previous church teaching. So it's a very, very significant move forward in our understanding of revelation, and our understanding of communication, and our understanding of scripture. Okay, so to understand that, what we have to do though is look at tradition, because tradition is a vital part of the communication of God. And to understand scripture, we have to understand where the tradition comes from. And the other documents of the Second Vatican Council are documents which try to unpack what is the tradition of the Church? What is this lived faith of the Church which is there? These are just not non-scriptural things, but the scripture is rooted within all that. And that's why in every document, the scriptures are there. And everything that happens now within the Church is rooted in scripture. But it's not only scripture, it's not scripture as opposed to unwritten tradition. So tradition is crucial to who we are as Catholic Christians, because the teaching of tradition has changed because of Dei Verbum, and it's something that we have to understand if we're to get a bigger picture of what the Church teaches about God's communication to us. So before Dei Verbum, tradition, what was it? It was this collection that we spoke of almost in propositional terms. It was customs, it was laws, it was doctrinal pronouncements that in some sense added to revealed scriptures. Okay, so that was the old notion of what tradition was. What Dei Verbum teaches us is that teaching and how communication, God's communication, is revelation, and it's transmitted in an incredibly dynamic manner. If you think of doctrinal statements or propositional truths, they're not dynamic. They'll just take it or leave it. But what Dei Verbum is a tradition. That's not what tradition is. Tradition is that lived experience. It's the faith which is alive and challenging and moving us forward. That's what tradition is. People think tradition is something that happened in the past. Tradition is what has happened in the present. Tradition is that lived experience of the past which is becoming real in the present. So the document recognises it's in the teaching of the Church, it's in the life of the Church, it's in the worship of the Church that the Church passes on to future generations what revelation is all about. So we don't pass on to the future generations propositional truths. That's not how the faith is passed on. The faith is passed on through propositional truths plus the lived experience of faith, that dynamic communication of God, which is God's desire to be in relationship with who, with God's people. So unlike earlier teachings in the Church, which we had right up to the Council, Dei Verbum doesn't relegate revelation to the past. If revelation is God's communication, if God is willing to be in relationship with us, it's not happening in the past, it's also the ongoing communication of God today. So even though it's rooted in Christ, even though it all emanates and centered in Christ, it's still happening today. God is communicating, inviting us, and challenging us, moving us, communicating with us in all that happens within our world today. So revelation is dependent on Christ, but it continues every time God is in dialogue and God is in friendship, and we respond to that invitation from God in our relationship with Him. So Dei Verbum is moving us forward to tell us that God is directly involved, communicating with us, revealing Himself to us in human affairs. God is revealing Himself in the tradition which we are part of the entire body of Judeo-Christian tradition, which is this record of God's relationship with us, God's covenant, where he chose his people and is in relationship with them, right down to where we are today and the church that we're rooted in. So, hopefully what's come across from that, the understanding of tradition, within our understanding of revelation, it is far from being static. And we've got to get away from that notion of tradition being static. The church itself is not static, and it cannot be static. It must grow, and it must evolve, and it must be real, interacting with who God is and the truth that God continues to reveal, helping us understand in a far deeper and a far more intimate manner. So, tradition is a wonderful tradition. It's a wonderful concept for us to understand how we pass on from one generation to another our understanding of God, and the communication that God has given, is giving, and will give to us. So now the tradition, yes, it's doctrines, and it's formula, and it's things which are pronouncements, but it's far more than that. Tradition is the lived faith that we have, and although magisterial teachings are part of that body of truth which is passed on, tradition is about the lived faith. Tradition is about how the church lives today and communicates that faith that we have. So in a year of faith, that's very much part of the tradition of the church. So we are living the tradition of the church today, and God is communicating with us in that tradition, that communication that he has, which leads us right on to one of the privileged means of that tradition is our scripture. And so the scripture has a privileged encounter with God. God communicates to us through the scriptures. So revelation is rooted in the proclamation of God's word. We know that the revelation that we have in our understanding of God is rooted in the oral proclamation, because that's where we got the good news, that's how the message was carried on to us from the apostles and the early church community, but it was continued under the guidance and under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit when it was committed to writing. So the tradition of the church, the lived faith of the church, came to a point when, instead of just being an oral proclamation, it was a written record of what that church, that teaching was, and what that faith was. So scripture and that recognition of that written word, recognised the word of God is the bigger thing, but this is the written word within that, is recognised as a privileged means of God's communication to us, which is the inspired word which has been given to us and has been revealed to us. And so what Dei Verbum does is situates scripture within that bigger picture of God's self-communication, and it affirms the doctrine, the teaching of inspiration. Right? So we want to understand the scriptures, we recognise them as inspired. But inspiration, and ultimately, God is the author of the scriptures, and the Holy Spirit is involved in writing the scriptures. But at the same time, the authors have a role to play within the writing of the scriptures. It's not as if the Holy Spirit was on somebody's shoulder and was guiding the hand. The Spirit was involved. Inspiration was there because it was of the desire and the communication of God. But the human authors somehow were involved in that communication as well. So scripture is God's word, which is mediated through the testimony of these human authors, the lived faith of that church community. So in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, we have God's word. So when we have our readings on a Sunday, the word of God, the Old Testament is the word of God, as is the New Testament, the word of God, the communication of God. So God is communicating. So we have that history of our relationship, that covenant relationship, where God chooses these people and leads these people and offers them that salvation, becomes the climax in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. So the word of God is proclaimed and passed on to us in that written form. Because both the Old Testament and the New Testament are united in form under the one Holy Spirit, the inspiration of God. So God is the author, and thus the Bible has an authority that is unparalleled in other human literature. Because God is the author of the scriptures in a way in which God is not the author of anything else. Shakespeare was inspired, but it was not biblically inspired. There's a different concept of what inspiration is. It contains not only a human message, but it contains a divine message. That's the inspiration. It's offering us something, a communication of God, which is inspired in a way which, yeah, we can encounter God and all these other things, but this is a privileged means of that. These human authors were indeed inspired to write. But we also have to recognise, and this is where Dei Verbum moves us forward as well, that they were limited by their use of diverse literary genres, they were limited by metaphorical language, they were limited by the influences of their time and their culture. And that's okay. It's not a weakness, it's not a limitation in the scriptures, it's a reality. And so when we read the scriptures, we can see that. That's okay. There can be mistakes. Luke can say one thing, Matthew can say something else. That's okay. We can live with that, the diversity, because the truth is contained within it, in that inspiration. So in bringing this out, the role of the authors themselves, the fact that they were within a community, they were passing on that faith, their own experience of the faith, what the document does is totally reject a biblical fundamentalism. Okay? And it discards the view held before the council that scripture is totally without error in all matters religious and profane. Now some people will look at the scriptures and think it's without error because it's inspired by God. But of course there are errors in the scripture. Of course there are. No, one says one thing, one says something else. No. It doesn't have to be factually correct in order still to be inspired. So it's moving us forward, because prior to that, if there was something which was not factually correct, it was seen, well, it couldn't be in the scriptures. Dawkins moving us forward, asking us to see the bigger picture within that. So it's now clear that the teaching of the church is that scripture is inspired, but inspired with a view towards the faithful communication of God's saving offer to us. It is inspired because God is offering us through those scriptures his communication, his love, his offer of a covenant relationship. God is offering us his communication in scripture. He's not offering us an inspired view of historical or scientific accuracy. That's not what scriptures are about. So if we use them in order to beat people about the head for scientific or historical accuracy, we've lost the meaning of what the scriptures are. So it teaches us about scripture, about inspiration, about truth, which is the greater truth. So when it's teaching us about inerrancy, which was that big struggle within some of the council fathers, Dei Verbum admits the possibility of human limitation, human deficiency, and even errors in the authorship of the sacred texts, but in such a way that God's saving truth is still faithfully communicated through the medium of the entire biblical testimony. And that's wonderful. That opens up, liberates us from a fundamentalist notion of the scriptures. It gives us a relationship with God which is far more freeing and a far greater opportunity of encountering the freedom of God for us. So what is true about the scriptures is the truth that God wishes to be put into writing for the sake of our salvation. So when we read the scriptures, we read them and we hear the scriptures, it's in order that we are going to be saved. So they're written for the sake of our salvation. That's what they're about. So we hear God communicating to us when those scriptures are proclaimed, saying, I want you to be saved. This is the way in which you can be saved. Follow this message, principally the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and salvation is offered for you. So, if we can recognise that the scriptures are inspired, they're true for the sake of our salvation, then this formulation keeps us as a Catholic Church out of the orbit of fundamentalism and an approach to inspiration and biblical inerrancy, which is fundamentalist, and which really was characteristic of an element within the church community before the council. So what the church did then, this concept of truth, of inspiration, is drop that idea of inerrancy and concentrate on truth. The truth is what we're about. The scriptures are in the business of the truth which is being communicated, not this idea of inerrancy. And Dei Verbum therefore goes beyond absence of error to a far more positive approach to what the scriptures are offering us. So, like to that, we have Sorry, that the council document said, if that's what the scriptures are, then everyone should have access to them. We've got to move out, we've got to move into the orbit of what the scriptures are saying to us. That it's no longer the meat for a privileged few, but it's for everyone to encounter God through the scriptures. So, study the scriptures and encourage the Catholic theologians to actually get into that movement of biblical study, and they have a huge contribution that they've made since the time of the council. And before the council, there were people who were sowing the seeds and helping this to happen. But it was recognised any group which was meeting had to meet with the scriptures. There had to be an understanding of the scriptures, are the privileged means for that communication to help pass the tradition of the church. And so pastoral use of scriptures, praying the scriptures, studying the scriptures was to be encouraged, and it has become part of who we are in the Catholic community. But that's only happened because of Dei Verbum. But alongside the scriptures and tradition, and we come to the role of the magisterium. Alan's a smiling. So, what's the role of the magisterium? And this is significant, because this is where we differ from the other traditions that are very much rooted in the scriptures. We can have a lot of agreement in the scriptures, we have some disagreement on tradition, we have a lot of disagreement on tradition, but what's the role of the magisterium? Who has the authority to interpret scriptures? And within the Catholic community, Dei Verbum recognises the role of the magisterium, but in a very nuanced and a way which can help us to understand that. So according to Dei Verbum, there is a direct movement from the apostles to the bishops in order to protect the authenticity of the faith. And look at Lumen Gentium, and look at the bigger picture of where the magisterium fits in, how the people of God are connected to the hierarchy within the church's community. But in Dei Verbum, it's looking at this from the idea of the authenticity of faith. But what it does do, Dei Verbum breaks away from the view that the magisterium is the exclusive agency of tradition. The council, the popes, the bishops, they are the ones who are in charge of tradition. Dei Verbum moves beyond that. The magisterium are not the only ones who have a role to play within tradition. Because if tradition is the lived faith of the church, then we all have that responsibility. What the text does though, it acknowledges the necessary role that we have within the Catholic community for bishops in the task of authentically interpreting the scriptures. That the bishops, with their mandate and with their role on behalf of the community, they have a role to recognise where scripture and tradition are united. But it does stress that all believers have a spiritual gift for discerning God's word that enables them to contribute to the tradition. Right? So, again, compromised document, bringing everything in, which is lots of different pieces of the jigsaw, the magisterium have a particular role to play. That's fine, because we entrust our bishops with that role. But they are not the exclusive people within that role. The document is very strong that all believers have got to encounter God through their understanding of God's communication. Because of our baptism, and this will come when Joe talks about the universal call to holiness and Lumen Gentium, which is there, because of our baptism, every single believer has this supernatural instinct, or has this sense of faith that allows every individual believer to recognise what is God's word and to respond to it. That's colossal. That's Catholic teaching. See, that every single believer has the supernatural instinct, the sense of faith which is given us in our baptism to encounter God's word, to know God's word, and to respond to it, to live out God's word. The magisterium has a role within that. They have this role as the authentic interpreters of what God's word is, of scripture and tradition, to authentically interpret that within the community, but always under the direct guidance of the Holy Spirit, because it's the Holy Spirit who guarantees the authenticity of the truth. It's not the magisterium who create the truth. The truth is the truth. It's not true because the magisterium says true. It's true because it's true. And the Holy Spirit is the authenticator of the truth which God is offering us. So, the magisterium is not superior to the Word of God, and the document stresses that. Rather, the magisterium is the servant of God's word. And as a servant of God's word, their role is to think and interpret that, which is the word of the community. So this acknowledgement that God communicates through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to all believers, and not only through the ministry of the Magisterium, is a decisive contribution in the story of Vatican II. Huge, huge contribution. It opened up the mystery of the workings of the Holy Spirit to the entire body of the faithful, and so allowed this expansion of God being God who's communicating to all people, not only communicating with Pope, not only communicating with bishops, but rather bringing every single person into that relationship with God, and allowing every single person to encounter God in that personal, dynamic way. So it's wonderful. It's a very, very positive open document. But, of course, the sense of compromise that we mentioned earlier has got to come into play as well, and can be seen in our understanding of how where the Magisterium fits into scripture and tradition. Because the teaching office, which is the Magisterium, is simultaneously the servant of the word and is its authentic interpreter. Okay? So the whole church determines the development of tradition, but the whole church is subordinate to the teaching authority of the Magisterium. So, figure that one out if you can. So that's the whole mystery of the scripture, tradition, magisterial relationship, which is there. And that's what makes it so wonderful. And that's what makes it so dynamic. And that's why there's so much tension within it as well, which is, where's the Holy Spirit leading us? Where is the gift of faith? What is this in the supernatural sense of faith? The faith that the bishops authentically interpret is the faith that we share, the faith that we live. So there's got to be a relationship with it. They don't make a decision, which is their decision. They make a decision, which is the faith of the people. So that's basically the document, which is there, just to say, what are the implications of that then? If Dei Verbum was a hugely important document for understanding of the communication of God and of revelation and of scripture and of tradition, what the application of that document? Huge over the last 50 years. Something quite new in Dei Verbum is the encouragement of an ecumenical approach to biblical translation and to dissemination of our understanding of the scriptures. Hugely moving us forward. When Alan does the ecumenical document in a number of months' time, he went into that in more detail, how important the document on ecumenism was, but it links in with the document on revelation, because it's saying, if we are to understand the communication of God, we have to do it ecumenically, because we can learn so much from the other churches in our journey towards understanding God's communication. So, a big, big ecumenical acknowledgement and an encouragement to our scripture scholars to work ecumenically. Dei Verbum is so strong in the pastoral implication and the pastoral application of the scriptures in the life of the church that it's moved us forward enormously. The explicit encouragement of Catholics, and indeed encouragement of all Christians, to become familiar with the Bible is a new thing within our church tradition. Encouraging us not to be afraid of the Bible, not to keep out there in case you don't understand what it's saying, in case you want to be led astray, but yes, use the Bible, enter into the truths of the Bible, allow the Bible to be that privileged means of encountering God. All Christians have to use that. This renewed understanding of the scriptures given in Dei Verbum was accompanied also by a recognition that the church is nourished in two ways, by the Word of God and the body of Christ. So the whole kind of movement towards our worship, worshipping at the table of the word and the table of the altar. In other words, we have the real presence of Christ proclaimed in the word. And we have the real presence of Christ present in the sacrament. And both are equally the presence and the presence of Christ. So the word of God, which is proclaimed, is the real presence. And the body and blood, which become, sorry, the bread and wine, which become the body and blood, are the real presence. Those two presences are how we understand this communication of God through our worship. So we're recognising the Word of God in its fullness, the Word of God, which is far greater than just a proclamation, but the Word of God, which is that lived experience. The Word of God has got to be central in our Catholic worship and in our Catholic life. Dei Verbum, for this past motion, does recognise that the scientific study of the Bible has got to take prominence within our Catholic culture. And so, yes, we need scripture scholars, we need people to lead us forward, we need people to help us to unpack the scriptures, because it's a privileged means of encountering God. The document itself hugely influenced the Catechism of the Catholic Church. The Catechism of the Catholic Church actually cites Dei Verbum 77 times, making it the fourth cited document in the text. Don't ask me how I do that, that's it. I found it from a reliable source. The only other documents from the Council which are cited more in the Catechism than Dei Verbum are the three other constitutions, the Gaudium et Spes, Lumen Gentium, and the one on liturgy. So, clearly, Dei Verbum enshrined this notion of going to the scriptures, recognising the role of the author, what's the history behind each of them, unpacking the different layers in which it was written, the layer of the community, the layer of the oral proclamation, the layer of the written proclamation, the layer of how that was then received, recognising that Bible study is important and the ways in which we do that are crucial. But, and what I have to say is that increased interest in the scriptures among Catholic laity and Catholic clergy hasn't necessarily led to increased knowledge. And that's where we have increased interest, a lot more interest perhaps, but we have still to do a lot more work to become aware of where the scriptures are and what the scriptures can actually teach us. So we need to go beyond fundamentalism, and we're still at a huge danger of biblical fundamentalism within our communities. Fundamentalism is attractive to people who look to the Bible for ready answers to the problems of life. And that's the danger. Let's go to the Bible because it's now available to us and we'll find all the answers there. It can deceive people because it offers interpretations that are pious, that are illusory, instead of encouraging people to recognise that the Bible doesn't contain an immediate answer to every problem. That's not what it's designed for. And if we use it in that fundamentalist notion, then we've limited God's communication to us. Fundamentalism, that's the danger we've got to avoid, and as Catholic Christians we've got to be aware of it, that it injects a false certitude into life. That's not what the Word of God is about, because it confuses the divine substance of this biblical message with the human limitations that we all live with and have to encounter. But we've got wonderful opportunities to use the scriptures and understand the scriptures. We've got it in our lectionary, we've got it in lectionary-based catechesis in our RCIA, we've got whole community catechesis which are rooted in the scriptures which are there. We've got it in Lectio Divina, which is encouraged all over the place during Lent. We've got it in Lent study groups that are looking at scripture passages, we've got things in the midst of the year of Luke. All that stuff is helping us to be aware of the scriptures. And what in this whole new evangelization that we're part of in the church today, new evangelization is rooted in the scriptures and demands that we work in the scriptures as well. So, if I can bring all that together, what about Dei Verbum? What about this helping us with the scriptures? Dei Verbum has to be seen as one of the most significant documents which was produced by the Council Fathers. And we owe a huge debt to the Fathers of the Council who struggled with it and who really made sure that we got beyond the literalism and the propositional idea of Revelation, and they really helped us to see this wider notion of the Word of God in its entirety. It broadened our horizons regarding God's revelation by focusing the self-communication of God in the person of Jesus. It moved us beyond seeing Revelation as a list of truths to be believed to something that's far more relational and is far more about mystery and helps us to enter into mystery. It's to be entered into, not to be explained. It brought scripture and tradition back together as the means where God does communicate with us, and it highlighted the role of the magisterium within our Catholic tradition as authentic interpreters of our faith, but not as the sole agents or the sole mediators of God's communication in our world. The unity therefore offered in Dei Verbum is a complex mixture. It's a complex unity of scripture, of tradition, and of magisterium, but it gives us the direction that Vatican II has offered us and that we as the Catholic community have got to follow. As a document, it's very even-handed, far more even-handed than previous documents. It's far less polemical than the previous documents. It's far broader in its outlook, and that will be seen in other documents which it touches and which it encourages, and the other documents which recognise the role of the scriptures and the role of tradition. The traditional post-Reformation contrast that we had within the Catholic Church with Protestantism as the religion of the world and Catholicism as the religion of the sacrament has come to an end with Dei Verbum, because the Word of God is the Word and the sacrament, it's the scripture and tradition which are united. So Dei Verbum, because of its status as a dogmatic constitution of an ecumenical council, therefore has the highest teaching authority within our church teaching, and it has confirmed and encouraged the direction which we have gone over the last 50 years in this rediscovery of the Bible within the life of the church. Of course, it's not the final word, and that's good, because no document is, and we've got to continue to move forward. If we are part of the tradition, it's a lived faith, it will continue to change, develop, and grow. And Dei Verbum is not the final word. There are issues which we must grapple with today. The complex relationship of scripture and tradition, again, we've got to keep with it. The role of the methods of biblical study, historical, critical method, is one method which is there. There are other methods which we just have to continue to look at. We have to recognise that there are difficulties with the translation. We've seen it in the translation of our liturgy for the Mass. We're in the process of a new translation for the lectionary, but hopefully that one, it might take a wee while before it happens. There's still the challenge of biblical fundamentalism, which is within ourselves and within our community. So all in all, as a document, it gives us wonderful insights into faith that we can have in this year of faith. It's good that its riches have been brought to the surface, that the riches of scripture and tradition are part of our church teaching. The magisterium is connected to the scripture and the tradition. I would encourage you to enter into that as a document to really benefit from it.